Australia is currently experiencing a case wave in terms of COVID-19, but not a death wave in terms of COVID-19. Right now, their 7-day rolling average of death in Australia, which is a country of some 25 million people, is 4. They've been having 3 or 4 deaths a day. And yet, the measures that they have been taking in order to crack down on people's basic freedoms are absolutely insane. I mean, it looks like some sort of outtake from a dystopian film. Apparently, over the weekend, Australian rescue dogs were shot dead over COVID-19 lockdown restrictions. Several dogs slated to be rescued, according to the New York Post, were shot dead in rural Australia due to a local council's interpretation of the country's COVID-19 lockdown restrictions. Apparently, the pups were executed to prevent volunteers in an animal shelter from traveling to pick up and rescue the animals last week and potentially spreading the virus at the same time. So that is delightful. Joining us on the line to discuss all this is Satya Marar. He is a Sydney and Washington, D.C.-based policy writer and foreign-trained legal professional. He writes extensively on economics and international relations and civil liberties, and he's just returned from Australia. Satya, thanks so much for joining the show. Appreciate it.
Hey, Ben. Thanks for having me on.
So can you give us an update on what's going on in Australia? Because they've done pretty well in terms of keeping down the deaths. They're a giant island. So, I mean, that basically helps. But they've been locked down for basically a year and a half, and it seems like things are getting worse over there.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, for a long time, for the first 1.5 years of this pandemic, Australia had some very tough restrictions internally, lockdowns that went on for 1 or 2 months at a time that seemed to eventually bring the outbreak of the pandemic under control. And we had border closures. We had 2 weeks of quarantine for anyone who flew into the country. But the latest outbreak of Delta, which began in Sydney towards the end of June, has put Sydney into a lockdown that has gone on for 2 months and will probably keep going further. And despite the fact there have been some very harsh restrictions in place, you can't travel more than a few miles from your own house to exercise. You can't even congregate with any more than one person who isn't from your household outdoors, you know, when you go out and exercise. And there are very few exceptions for leaving your house, and the police enforce them very strictly with up to $5,000 or even more in fines. And you're finally seeing, you know, thousands of people come out in the streets of Melbourne or Sydney to protest. The police have put them down very harshly using rubber bullets and tear gas a few days ago. It's absolutely terrible. And the thing is, despite this, we're still seeing hundreds of new cases every single day. And the government's response to this isn't to cut the people some slack and say, okay, look, this isn't doing as well as what we thought it would. It is to keep pursuing the strategy that they have in place and to tighten the restrictions even further.
Now, one of the things that's very odd about Australia is that despite all of this focus on lockdowns, the percentage of the population that's fully vaccinated remains pretty low. I believe it's only about 25% of the population in Australia is actually fully vaccinated at this point, as compared with the evil, horrible United States, in which well over 70% of the population that's adult is vaccinated at this point. So why aren't more people vaccinated in Australia?
Well, in some ways, we're the victims of our own success and also of our own, our government's complacency and incompetence, really. So around June of last year, health officials from our government met up with officials from Pfizer. This was around the same time that the U.S. placed in orders for tons of Pfizer vaccines. At the time, Australia actually didn't go ahead with it. They ended up ordering a much smaller batch of that months down the track. We threw all our eggs into the AstraZeneca basket, which was unfortunate because, you know, you ideally want to have many different sources of vaccines. And the government simply didn't see the need to roll it out, that quickly. A lot of young people were lining up for vaccines, unable to get an appointment. And a lot of older people also thought, well, you know what? Community spread is almost nothing, thanks to the border quarantines and so on. So, you know, we'll be fine. We don't need to hurry this up. It's not a race. The comments, "it's not a race," were actually used by our prime minister. He now regrets that deeply. So it's all fine until it wasn't. And now, you know, not even 40% of our population is vaccinated. And the government has said, until we get to 80%, lockdowns are still going to be a fact of life. Now, I'm sorry, but we're not going to get there for months.
Yeah, I mean, that is an insane statement, given the fact that the kind of lockdowns you've been talking about. I mean, I was watching the tape earlier today from Nine News in Australia, and they're talking about, you know, individuals who have been quarantined. If they go down an elevator and then they just walk out the front door, now there's like national manhunts on for people who have COVID-19. You have teenagers who are congregated on beaches. Teenagers, by the way, are not dying from COVID-19. Like anywhere. Okay, COVID-19 does not affect young people in the same way it affects older people. The total number of people in the United States under the age of 18, for example, who have died of COVID-19 remains at 361 out of a subpopulation of 73 million in the United States, which again is almost 3 times the entire population of Australia. So you have 8 teenagers who are being arrested and fined $1,000 for being on the beach, like in the middle of the night outside. And yet, how many members of the Australian population are willing to go along with these restrictions at this point. Are there any poll numbers demonstrating any sort of blowback to this?
Look, you know, from the polling, there's not been that much polling yet, to be honest, but from what we've seen on social media, there seems to be wide public support for these restrictions, broadly speaking. In fact, it seems a lot of people would much rather blame the few thousands who are slowly growing and turning out to protest against what's happening than they would like to blame the government, who are actually responsible for this imprisonment strategy that has been imposed on us. And what people don't seem to understand is that this really isn't as simple as even getting to that 80% target that the government has arbitrarily set. Israel is one of the few countries that's made it that far, and even they are seeing 19 people still die in hospital a day. So unless you're willing to change and abandon the zero COVID strategy, which all but one of our major governors are yet to abandon, it's going to keep getting worse. And unfortunately, the media, some sections of the media haven't been great about this either. They've tried to, you know, portray all the protesters as being far-right conspiracy theorists or anti-vax extremists. Some of them might be, but many of these are people from low-income backgrounds, from the suburbs, from immigrant backgrounds, working-class people who've actually been affected badly by this, not your average punter at home who's got a job that they can do via Zoom for the most part.
So how is Australia's economy reacting to all of this? So lockdown policies in the United States had a dire effect on the American economy. As lockdown has been alleviated, it is no coincidence that the heavier lockdown states in the United States have rebounded at an extraordinarily slow rate compared to the ones that have opened up much wider. The top 10 states in terms of growth in the United States are all red states that reopen pretty quickly. The bottom 10 states in terms of growth have been blue states that have failed to reopen quickly. What's the economy in Australia doing, given the fact that people are basically relegated to their homes?
Well, for most of the pandemic, we actually did reasonably well. You know, we didn't suffer as much of a hit as the U.S. did, and then our recovery was fairly strong. But there are a few specific reasons for this. So firstly, the government obviously spent a lot of money on relief packages, which in some ways is kicking a can down the road. But secondly, you know, we're a commodity exporter in a big way, and we export a lot of iron ore, especially to China, which ironically, we're in a trade war with China, and China's trying very hard to wean themselves off us because they know that we're close to the USA. So that's not going to last forever. And our construction industry has been absolutely booming. People are throwing a ton of money into real estate because, well, when the government turns on the money printing machine, this is where your family wealth has to end up. So, you know, it's going well for now, but with the latest lockdown, though, how long can it last? Normally, when we're in a boom time, which we technically are right now, that money is used to pay off debt. We keep incurring debt. It's, you know, it remains to be seen what the long-term severe effects of this might be.
I'm just laughing here because becoming reliant on China in the aftermath of a pandemic unleashed on the world by China is definitely a unique economic strategy, given the fact that China's been extraordinarily robust in its hatred for the Australian government and in its belief that the Australian government is an interfering government in its own internal affairs.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, they've tried hard to strong-arm Australia. They've taken issue with us for one, calling them out on their role in COVID-19, which, you know, they've covered up any objective investigation into. They've tried to get Huawei into our country to build our sensitive network infrastructure. We said no, and they've thrown a massive fuss. They demanded that we let them do that as a condition for having normal relations. They would never accept it if we send one of our companies there to build their sensitive infrastructure. So really, you know, they're using these bullying tactics. And so far, we've done all right simply because they need our iron ore really badly. And, you know, they're trying to find supplies in Africa. They're trying to, you know, work out arrangements with other countries. And really, for now, we've done fine, but it remains to be seen how long that will last.
So as I mentioned before, and as you mentioned before, there have been some pretty large scale protests. Maybe you can describe the size of these protests. And is this going to be, you think, a growing movement in Australia? Or is it just going to peter out and this is going to be the new Australian normal pretty much forever?
It's hard to tell what this will look like in the future. I can tell you that there was a huge protest in Sydney a few weeks ago, early on during lockdowns, that attracted about 15,000 people, but the media tried playing that figure down, even though all the footage shows the exact opposite. The protests recently in Melbourne were a few thousand. A lot of the people in these videos are just ordinary, normal people who've been affected badly and directly by the lockdowns. Now, one of the things is the government has not only made it illegal to protest, they've also made it illegal to promote the protests. So I have to be careful in what I say. You know, if I word my Facebook post wrongly, I could come across like I'm condoning horrible criminal activity, such as going outdoors and holding a sign up. As we all know, that's what leads to, you know, the killing of innocent people, apparently, and not the use of heavy-handed police tactics, which is what has happened. And keep in mind, I saw video footage recently. There was this one father, he brought his son with him to the protest. They were holding up a sign saying, "Let me play," because for some unscientific reason, the Victorian government has shut down the outdoor playgrounds, even though the science says that kids are at very low risk and outdoor activity is at very low risk and exercise is good for you. That kid ended up being pepper sprayed, I assume, when the police talked to the crowd. So this is absolutely horrific. It makes no sense. It clearly has, you know, some of these restrictions have no basis in health whatsoever, leave alone a proportionate basis. And the police are actually, in New South Wales, for example, the police are helping to write the restriction they're enforcing. So it's not just the health bureaucrats giving health input. It's the police saying, hey, this is how you can make my job of being able to strong arm and fine people a lot easier, which is why some of these rules have come in place, even though the science says otherwise.
Have there been any lawsuits brought in Australia, any constitutional lawsuits? And what have the courts said about any of this? Because as you mentioned, I mean, if it is now becoming illegal to protest and illegal to even stump in favor of protesting or mention protest, like, how is this not violative of basic human freedoms in Australia at this point?
There are a few cases that are ongoing, and I do know that many fines that have been issued have ended up being overturned. A lawyer associate of mine, he was recently involved in cases involving some of the restrictions that were brought in last year during the worst of those lockdowns. It's a habeas corpus violation. So that has been happening. It'll take some time for these cases to go through fruition. But keep in mind, we don't have the kind of liberal rights defending constitution that you guys have, the kind of protections of free speech and free assembly, for example. So it's a much bigger uphill battle. And in fact, there was a recent court ruling. I believe it had to do with the border closures, either the interstate border closures or the border closures to the outside world. And the court actually ruled and said that Biosecurity Act, which is being used by the federal government for some of these restrictions, that act explicitly has the power to overrule fundamental human rights. And we've seen some, the court has actually come out and said that. And we've seen some of the emergency powers in the states being used to override basic civil rights protections. So it looks very grave at the moment, but you know, full credit to the legal eagles who are fighting those battles right now.
You mentioned travel restrictions into Australia. You mentioned that people who are coming in have to quarantine for a full 14 days. I mean, effectively, is there any travel into Australia at this point? I would assume not a lot of people are coming in.
Unless you're an Australian national, you cannot legally travel into Australia. The exception being, I mean, they have given exceptions. Caitlyn Jenner flew in, a few celebrities from the UK flew in to shoot Celebrity Big Brother. Because it turns out all you have to do, well, Hollywood stars have come in, no problem. They've been able to quarantine on their own in nice, lovely hotels. All they had to do is pay a ton of money for the privilege. Your ordinary person who wants to go out in the world, see their dying relatives overseas, or fly in here to see someone they haven't seen in years, sometimes their own children, has a massive uphill battle. Now, I got lucky that I was even able to leave because I had to apply for an exit visa, an exemption from the government to travel. I'm studying over here, so I was able to do that. But you know, I know other people have absolutely struggled to unite their families, and it's really cruel, and it's sending this message that there's a separate rule for the rich and the ordinary Australian, and your citizenship documents aren't worth as much as you'd like them to be worth. There's only, I believe, three countries now that require travel exemptions for their own citizens to even leave. I believe the other two might be Syria and North Korea. So, look, I tell people this, and over here, and they don't get it. They go, "I thought the worst thing about Australia were the mean spiders." No, it's not. It's our government, as it turns out.
Unbelievable, Satya Marar. Thank you for your coverage. Really appreciate the time. And that is some horrifying stuff.